Well, good evening.
Good evening.
Let's begin by praying together. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come, to open your word, to hear you speak to us. We pray that that would happen, that these would not simply be things that we look at and talk about, but that we would hear you speaking. Forgive the weaknesses that I will have in what I share, but we pray that your truth would be heard for your glory. So we entrust ourselves to you in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, we are making our not enormously swift way through the book of Colossians here tonight, and we'll continue on with that. I wonder if you've ever noticed that you can tell a lot about a person when you hear them pray. Christians I'm thinking of, or people who are at least professing Christians, you can hear them pray, and you can hear they use certain words or phrases or use a certain style. And if you've been around the Christian community for a while, you can think, oh, that person's been in that particular group, because there's certain key words or phrases or ways of saying things. If I listen to some of Elizabeth's family of siblings, I hear the King James Version, and I can think, oh, I know what they continue to read and continue to pray, and they're saturated in that. You can tell a lot about what people understand and what they know. Elizabeth met someone this past week when they were in Dallas. Actually, both of our kids, our son and his wife, work, so they have somebody come in to clean the house, and they were cleaning the house. Elizabeth was there with them and visiting, and this young man had a fairly interesting story of how God had come into his life, and she happened to mention that our daughter has cancer, and he was concerned about that. And she was trying to just sort of see where he was spiritually. And even though he understood a lot, he didn't have a real sense of understanding of the gospel that made him secure and sure. But he asked if he could pray. And Elizabeth just said, it was really interesting to pray because it was all pleading. It was no trusting. It was all calls for help, but there was no sense of underlying confidence in what she was saying. You can tell a lot about a person in terms of what their priorities are, too, when they pray. You listen to them, and what are they asking the Lord about? What's important to them? Sometimes people just get tongue-tied when they get up, especially if they're praying in public. It's something that's difficult to do, and so you can understand that, and some interesting things get said. Someone starts praying about God the Father, and then all of a sudden he's dying on the cross and doing things like that, and you understand they're just getting a little mixed up as they're going, nothing serious. And yet there's things to learn about prayer, and there's things to know about prayer that become helpful to us. And one of the great models of prayer in the Bible is, it's interesting that the only thing the disciples ever asked Jesus to teach them is to teach us to pray. I mean, he's teaching them all the time, but that's the only time they come to him that we're told, Lord, teach us to pray, because they immediately recognize something remarkable and distinctive about his prayer life, and out of that came what we tend to call the Lord's Prayer, only it's really the disciples' prayer. And it becomes a kind of basis for understanding about prayer. But the great model of prayer, obviously, is the Lord Jesus in how much time he gave to it. But in terms of knowing what he prayed, it's the Apostle Paul. And he prays fairly regularly in the New Testament. And it's interesting the kinds of things that he prays for about people. Let's just take a moment before we look at Colossians. We'll start at the book of Ephesians and think about, here's a man who's praying, and he cares about these people, and he's concerned about them. So what does he ask for? What is he praying to take place in their life? So Ephesians chapter 1, we're not going to read the whole prayer. I just want you to notice the kind of beginning of it. But in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15, for this reason, because I've heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I don't cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in all my prayers. And here's what he prays for: that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your heart enlightened. And he carries on from that particular point. Now, chapter 3 and verse 14. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family or the entire family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he would grant you, now here's his prayer request, to be strengthened with power through his spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in faith, in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints. And he carries on from that particular point. The book of Philippians, the next book over to the right in your Bibles, in chapter 1. It is my prayer, it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Now, we could go on and on, but let's go to the book of Colossians, the next book over, and look at another one of his prayers, and you'll begin to see some of the things that are on his mind that keep coming back over and over. Now, let me remind you, as we come here to read these verses, Paul is writing to a group of people he's never met before. Ephesus, he'd spent 2 years in Ephesus. Philippi, he had had one of the most significant times of ministry there, and he greatly loved that particular church. You remember he'd been imprisoned and then the earthquake and all of the other things that happened in that city. But Colossians, he's never been to Colossae, never met nearly any of the people that are in that church, who are part of that congregation. So he's going to pray for people he does not know. Now, he began, as we noticed last week, as he commonly does in verse 3, by thanking God. So you notice verse 3, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. And so from verses 3 to 8, he's talked about why he's thanking God and that he's thanking God. So we know that he prayed for the Colossians. He's told us that in verse 3. But what did he pray for the Colossians? That's verse 9. And we'll talk about it a little bit later. This is one long sentence. So from verse 9 down to verse 14, if we were reading it in the original language, it would be one long, very complex sentence. And we'll unpack that in just a moment. And so we read, from the day we heard, meaning heard from Epaphras, about their faith and salvation and the things that are have been talked about earlier, we've not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He's delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Now, I want to look at that with you a little more closely, and I want to do about as boring a thing initially sounding as you can think of. I want you to see how this sentence is put together, because it's really pretty significant. And in your English translation, because, you know, a sentence that long just doesn't work in English, and you lose all connections. So every translation, and they'll all do it a little bit differently, has chopped it up into sentences. And that makes it interesting to read, but in the process, you end up missing sort of the connection that he's making here. So let me just walk it through with you. Can you stand that for a minute in terms of the grammar?
Yes, sir.
There is going to be, first of all, his petition. So I'll give you the process here. There's a petition. And the petition is connected to a purpose. And then the purpose is explained, and we'll see that. So let's just notice that, first of all, he makes it clear. Verse 9, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that. Okay, so here's the petition, that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual understanding, wisdom and understanding. What's Paul praying for? That you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. So as, in order that, this is the purpose. I want you to be filled so that something will happen. Okay? And the so that, or so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. So it's really important to notice the connection. The first part is, I want this to happen so that this will happen. If this doesn't happen, this won't happen. Understand, you can't walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects unless this happens. First of all, you're filled with the knowledge of his will. Then, and the way the English Standard Version has done it, what does it mean when it says to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, and then it gives... Now, I know most of us, our grammar isn't that strong in terms of coming the categories, but there are four participles that are used. And these four participles explain what a life that pleases God looks like. So it says, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, and you could easily translate, by bearing fruit. It's the first participle, by bearing fruit. And increasing, growing in the knowledge of God. And here's where the English Standard Version throws in a period where there is no period, because it's another participle. The beginning of verse 11, I better put my glasses on. I'm just kidding myself. I can't read these. Can't read the numbers. I can read the words. Verse 11 is actually being strengthened. So, bearing fruit, increasing, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance. Fourth participle, verse 12, giving thanks. Okay, so you're seeing how this fits together? I'm praying that, so that, bearing fruit, increasing, being strengthened, giving thanks. And then, I'll tip you off, we'll go here for a little bit. Verse 12, they've also chopped this one up into a sentence, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to, that's number one, giving thanks to the Father, number one, who's qualified you to share in the inheritance of the light, who has, still the same sentence, delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption. We're to give thanks for three things. We'll get to that right at the end. It's really some of the most important part. Now, on the one hand, I know that sort of going through that, but when you see what Paul is saying, it helps you understand that this is all fitting together in a particular way. What's his petition? His petition has expressed in that statement that they would have, sorry, we're blowing all over the place here, that they would fully know the will of God. Okay? So this is what I'm praying. I guess before we go there, we should just notice again about Paul's prayer life. He says, and so, or more literally, because of this, because I know of your faith in Christ. Remember, we looked at that last week of those of you here, your love toward all the saints and the hope that is laid up for you in heaven, because those three things are true of you. And he's gone on to say the rest of things. Because of this, from the very day we heard of your conversion, we've not ceased to pray for you. So Paul's prayer was, first of all, motivated by their new life in Christ. It was because of what God has done that he asks these things. He's convinced that they are believers. As we'll see, he's convinced that God has done a work in their life. And his prayer is in a context of thanksgiving for who God is and what he's done. And thirdly, it's constant. It's continuous. Now, I must confess, when I read Paul and every book, he begins by saying, I'm constantly praying for you. I wonder how he got time to do anything else. He must have been a pretty disciplined individual in terms of thinking through about his own prayer life. But even there, as we're thinking about praying, our praying is, first of all, guided by our understanding of what that person's spiritual state is. I mean, that's going to determine everything. If a person's not yet, we don't think, a follower of Christ, our prayers are going to be different. So he's praying because of this, or and so, as it begins in verse 10, out of a conviction of who they are in Christ. But what do you pray for people you don't know? How should you go about praying? What matters? And it's interesting, if you kind of listen to those prayers in Ephesians and in Philippians, and we could have gone and read some others, Paul has a kind of section of things. And I must confess, when I meet with others, and when we used to have staff meetings at church and we'd have prayer times and you'd ask people what to pray for, nearly always it was somebody had a physical need or a personal need, and we'd share and pray for their needs. And that's an important area of prayer. I mean, we want people praying for us when we've got a physical problem. We want people praying for us when we've got a practical need. And we want people, that's entirely appropriate. But all too often, we stay on that, I guess, mundane level and never get to the larger thing of what do they really need in their life? What really matters in their life? Physical health is a good thing. But physical health without, for example, salvation isn't an ultimate thing. So Paul sort of amplifies our prayer to the next level and says, what I really pray for you is that you would be filled with a knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and insight. Now, let's unpack that for a little bit. And talk about it. And just so you understand here, because my wife gave me fair insight last week. helpful insight last week. What we're going to do is stop partway through to have some time for interaction rather than saving them all up for the end. And so we'll go to the first two parts of this prayer, the petition, and then the purpose, and then we'll come back and we'll look at that last part after that. So if you've got some questions, we're going to divide it that way. See, I do listen to you regularly. So what is he asking for when he says that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will? Now, theologians love to do these kind of things, and it's true and it's valid. God's will sort of operates on different levels. There's God's sovereign will, God's decretive will. So the Bible says that the Lord is in his heavens. He does whatever he pleases. It's the plans and the purposes. He does all things according to the counsel of his own will, Ephesians chapter 1 tells us. So God is sovereign. God has a will. God has a purpose. God has a thing that he is doing in history, and it's working its way out. This is God's sovereign will. Now, some of that he's revealed to us in Scripture. It's God's will that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And everything is moving in that particular direction. But much of God's sovereign will is mysterious to us. We don't know that. And we look at life and we think, why did God sovereignly permit? Why did God sovereignly purpose? And sometimes we don't even know what word to use related to that. So there's God's sovereign will, where God is working out his purpose. There's another way of talking about God's will, and several times in the Bible it talks about that, and that's God's, pardon this word, but God's desiderative will, what God desires. Now, that's not the will he's going to enforce in that sense. So we read in the Bible, God desires all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. It's what God desires, and yet God's sovereign will that he's revealed in Scripture is that not all are going to come. How to put those two together gets to be a little bit mysterious. Then there's God's declared will. And what I mean by God's declared will is his moral will, to use it in the most simple way, that comes in the form of commands. What's God's will? You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make a graven image. Shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Keep the Sabbath. I mean, that's the declarative will of God, the declared will of God. It's the moral will of God. So there's all kinds of issues. Does God want me to cheat on my wife? His will is clear. I don't have to ask about that. I don't need to pray about that. And more than one occasion in a counseling session, somebody have come in and said, will you pray for me about this? And I said, absolutely not. I can tell you right now what God wants you to do. He wants you to break that affair and go back and be reconciled to your wife. I will not pray whether you should leave and marry this other woman. That's sin. Anyway, I think you understand. My counseling is not always gentle and quiet. But that's God's declared will. There's also God's personal will. What's God's will for my life? What does God want me to do? What does God want me to? Now, it's interesting, the Bible very rarely uses the term the will of God for the things that, what's God's will about what school I should attend? What's God's will about who I should marry? What's God's will about whether I should buy a new car? What's God's will about the kind of questions that were coming up regularly isn't nearly as central to us as it is, I mean, to the Bible as it is to us. That's not to say that God's not concerned about this, but anyway, we won't get into how to know God's will and walk into God's will. So the question comes, what is he want us to know, that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and insight? And in the book of Colossians, as it works itself out, because you would think that a good part of the rest of the book would be connected to that, and there's two things that are pretty clear. The first is God's will is that in everything Christ might have first place. That's where, before this sentence is over, I think I told you last week, the sentence goes all the way through to verse 14, and then he picks up another one at verse 15. And at the end of verse 18, he says that in everything, Christ might have preeminence. And that's the main thing he wants these Colossians to understand. If you want to know what the will of God is, you need to understand who Jesus is and what God's purpose is for Jesus. Because everything about God's will is related to the nature and identity and person of Christ. And then out of that, you need to know, and we'll get to this before we get even through this prayer, you need to know what then it means to live in such a way that is consistent with God's will and God's purpose. So one of the great verses in the book is in chapter 2 when he says, as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, so walk in him. Walk is the way in which I think the NIV nearly always translates it live or spend your life, but walking was just a Jewish way that Jewish people even now talk about the halakha, which is the Hebrew word for walking. And it's the kind of, okay, what's the pattern of behavior? What's the pattern of conduct that comes out of that? So how do I walk? How do I live my life? So the will of God in this context, that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. I'm sorry, I'm unpacking this, I know, fairly closely, but it's helpful too. When the Bible talks about being filled with something, I don't know what you think of, but the word that's most helpful for me is to think of controlled by. If you think of, if I say, that person is just full of grace, what do you mean? They're gracious. They're controlled by grace. If you say that person's full of anger, they're controlled by anger. I mean, we use that kind of terminology. When it talks about somebody who's filled with the Spirit, it means somebody who's controlled by the Spirit. When it talks about Stephen speaking, it talks about him being filled with wisdom. So he was controlled by wisdom in that particular. So he wants us to be filled with the knowledge of his will. Now, when the Hebrews talked about knowledge, they always thought way back to the beginning of the Bible, when one of the first statements that said, it's said all the way back in Genesis chapter 4, and it says, Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and had a son. Obviously, that knowledge isn't intellectual knowledge. It's intimate, personal knowledge. So the word about knowing in the Bible is intimate, personal knowledge, not just intellectual. So when he's saying, I want you to be controlled by the knowing of his will, he doesn't want you just to say, you can write a book about it. And then to just clarify what that knowledge is about, he says, with all spiritual wisdom and insight or discernment. So he wants these people to be, he wants them to know God's will. Now, by the way, I didn't say this earlier, but if you want to know the will of somebody, what do you have to first know? You need to know the person. I mean, there's all kinds of times. I don't need to know what Elizabeth's will is, because I know Elizabeth, and I know what her will is, even though she may be in another place. It's to clean this place so she doesn't have to come back to a terrible mess. I mean, that's one part of her will. Another part of her will is, our grandkids, they would love this, and so I buy it because I know that's her will to buy it. And the better you know a person, the more you know their will. And by the way, there's something very profound there. A lot of us times is, how do I know God's will? Get to know God. The best way you get to know God's will is you get to know God, and you're able, I mean, God's God, we'll never fully understand him. But you can know what is consistent with his character and consistent with his purposes and consistent with his glory. And that solves an awful lot of questions in life. If I think, what do I know about God that applies to this situation? It's another way of that old bit of cliche it's become, but it can be fair. What would Jesus do? And my answer to the question about what would Jesus do is hugely influenced by, who do I understand Jesus is? And the more accurately I understand who he is, the better I can pretty much guess what he would do under that particular situation and circumstance. So then he adds these other terms, with all spiritual wisdom and discernment. So what does he want these people? He wants them to know God's will, God's purposes, God's understanding, and to live with insight and discernment. And in, I think, all of the four prayer requests, in Ephesians 1, Ephesians 3, Philippians 1, and this one, every time Paul tells us what he's praying for, you'll find two things become dominant. It's understanding, discernment, knowledge, and the other is empowerment and ability. And so he's praying that they would have discernment of who God is and what God's purpose and what God wants them to do. So let's just jump to the next level, because this is all so that you might walk worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects. So his petition is that they would know God's will. His purpose is that they would live God-centered, God-pleasing lives. That you would walk worthy of the Lord. Excuse me. So here's the word worthy in the Hebrew language. It's a word axios, which refers to a balance scale. And the issue is that a worthy scale is one in which what is being measured against is, does this balance up to this? How do you measure things? And to walk worthy of the Lord is to ask the question, what balances with the Lord? Interesting. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, we are called to walk worthy of the calling with which we've been called. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 27, we're called to walk worthy of the gospel. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, the references slipped my mind right now, but I've got it here somewhere. Yeah, chapter 2, verse 12, it says, walk worthy of the God who called you. And then there's one more. It says in Romans chapter 16, when is talking about Phoebe, who's going to come and visit them, and then says, welcome her in a way that's worthy of the saints. But it's interesting that four times, walk worthy of your calling, walk worthy of the gospel, walk worthy of God, walk worthy of the Lord, and that's the one that's here. And whenever Paul speaks of the Lord in a context of this, he means the Lord Jesus. So walk worthy of the Lord Jesus. What's the standard? I want you to know God's will so that you would walk in a way that's worthy of the Lord Jesus. And, we live with this on a very different level. We don't tend to think of it in those terms, but we just think about, that behavior is not just not fitting. You can't do that and work for our company. That's not worthy. That's not the way we do things. It's not worthy of, good companies have that culture that says, we just don't go there. We don't do that. You tell it to your children. It's not the way you're going to do it. I don't want you. Walk worthy of being, an Inrig's not a very high standard, but it's the best we can do in our, walk worthy of that. You think of certain college kids, it's not worthy of the university, and colleges have to come out and apologize for the way in which their kids, or companies have to come out and apologize for the way it's done. Or you think of people in uniform, bearing the uniform of the United States, and that was conduct unbecoming. We even have a term to describe that. Conduct unbecoming of an officer. And it's interesting that when we're called, We're called to walk in a manner that's worthy of the Lord. So what I'm to put in the other side of the scale of my life is not my church, and it isn't other people, and it isn't rules and regulations. It's, how does this measure up to the Lord? Which is a very high calling. And then he comes to this next one. It says, and to please him in all respects. Is that the way it's translated? I'm sorry. Fully pleasing to him. It says it a little. I'm translating a little more precisely. To please him in all respects. So the idea is this. Is this pleasing to the Lord? Trying to please people. So, who was it that said, I can't tell you the method of success, but I can tell you the way to feel. Try to please everybody. And I think Ricky Nelson had a dumb old song years ago, you can't please everybody, so you got to please yourself. There's a wonderful philosophy of life. But the call is to live a life that's pleasing in all respects to the Lord. Fully pleasing is actually pleasing in all respects, which means in every area of life. It means that this is a kind of understanding and pattern that we take into all of life. So those are the primary things. And then Paul's now going to unravel that and say, okay, well, what does it look like to walk worthy of the Lord? How does that going to spell itself out? And what you'll begin to see in the light of Colossians is the answer he's going to give, and the answer he's already given, is totally different from what the Colossians were being given. Because they were being given a list of rules and regulations and walk worthy of those things. And Paul is setting them on a much higher standard and an entirely different standard. But it can only be done as they're empowered and enabled by the Holy Spirit. Okay, I said I was going to stop here and pause here, long way from stopping, and just see what have I confused you with? What do we need to unpack? What do we need to talk about a little bit more? Norm.
I'm just interested in the petition. And you say that Paul is encouraging them to know the Lord. But he's basically saying, I want you to believe in Judaism, and you need to study the will of the Lord in Judaism, because that was really the only written record of the Lord at the time. There was no New Testament. I don't even think the Gospels were widespread at that time, so anything they knew about Jesus would have been through Paul. And what was the belief system of the Colossians before all this? Were they polytheists?
Well, Colossae was not a large town. It had once been important and was much smaller, but it was a cultural stir fry. So you had basically the Phrygians, which were the locals who'd been there. It's in Turkey, about 100 miles in. It's in the Lycus Valley, and so you had the local long-standing, I guess you would say, Turkish peoples, although that actually isn't true, but we'll stick there for right now. So you've got the local population who would come out of a pagan pantheistic background. Then you have, because of after Alexander the Great, Alexander had swept through that area, conquered that area, and Hellenized that whole area, and first Greece, and then on top of Greece, Rome, which was a very kind of similar kind of structure. So you had this, it's called pagan element. You had the Hellenized element, culturally sophisticated and yet still polytheistic in terms of their understanding. And then you had a Jewish contingent, because after the Jews returned, well, actually 2 centuries before Christ, local leader, Antiochus IV, Antiochus III, had brought a bunch of Jewish settlers from Babylon to settle in the area, and there was estimated to be about 12 to 15,000 of them in that particular region. So it was quite a mixed area. And the Colossian church is composed of some with a Judaistic Jewish background. So, and that becomes very clear when you get into chapter 2. And he talks about these people with their backgrounds and their ceremonies and their Sabbath and the identity markers, the three major identity markers of Judaism, both then and ongoing in history, were food laws, ritual days, especially the Sabbath, and circumcision. And those become significant. So you had within the church some who'd come from a background of Judaism, others who'd come from a background of Hellenism and sort of Roman cultural lifestyle, and then you had those who came from the more folk religion of that particular area. So all of those have come together. They've heard the gospel. They become followers of Christ. They certainly, although it's interesting, the Old Testament is never quoted in the book of Colossians. That's very rare, but it's in New Testament writings, but it's clearly referred to and alluded to. So there's that kind of background. So when Paul is talking to them, they know the gospel. They know the message that the apostles have preached, the basic truths about Christ and the Christian teaching. Paul had been in the area for 2 years. Epaphras had been with him. He's come back. And he's embodied them. So when they know about the knowledge of his will, it clearly is in a Christian context and not in a Jewish context, although the roots of Christianity are deep within Judaism. So all of the Old Testament backgrounds and issues, and he will go back to that. We'll see it before we're over. He expects them to know the story of the Exodus. He expects them to know the story of the conquest of the land. He expects them to understand Old Testament symbolism. Before we get finished with this passage, you'll see where that is in this particular section.
And that was my question. I mean, he's essentially extolling them to learn the Old Testament, learn what Judaism is all about, and as modified by Christ walking on it.
Yeah, I put it a little bit differently, because some of them come from a Jewish background, he doesn't have to. But what they need to understand is what that they hoped and longed for within a Jewish framework has now come to its fulfillment. That Judaism was intended to lead to who Christ is, that he is the fulfillment of the hopes, and that he's the fulfillment of the promises of the Old Testament. And in some way, that makes the Old Testament look differently now. They need to understand that it was pointed toward a fulfillment, and that's what God has done in Christ. So when we get into the next section, beginning at verse 15, there is going to be a very Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, but his whole point is to be that God of Genesis 1 and Jesus are one together. So it wouldn't be true to say that he wants them to understand Judaism, but he wants them to understand how all that God had done in history through the Jewish people was preparing to bring them to its fulfillment in Christ. So,
I was interested in your explaining worthy, and I was wondering if you'd talk just a little bit about where in Revelation, you know, it talks about Jesus being worthy and how the scales.
Well, and that's a great question. How does, if you're talking about Jesus is worthy, how do you, when we've got something to compare with, we can balance the scale, but what are you going to put in the other side of the scale? Well, there's a certain sense, even in Revelation 5, which is the passage, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive glory and honor, power and dominion. And what they do in that passage is fall on their faces before him and treat him as they treated God, the Father, in chapter 4. So in very real sense, what they are doing is putting God the Father on the other side of that scale, along with Jesus, and honoring him as they would honor Jesus. When the angels appear in the book, and John in one passage falls on his face, he falls on his face before Jesus when he sees him, like a dead man, he puts it in chapter 1. There's a later point at which an angel appears and he falls on it. The angel says, get up. You don't fall on your face. I'm not on the other side of the scale. Don't treat me as if I was. So I'd never thought of it. I'm making this up as I go. But I think I think that whole idea of the worthiness of the Lord in verse 4, I mean, I've thought of it, but not in chapter 5. I've thought of it, but not quite in these terms, is putting Jesus on the same scale. Because it says, who is worthy to open the book or to loose its seals? And there was none worthy, and I began to weep. And the killers, behold, the lion, the tribe of Judah, has prevailed to open. And he walks and he takes the scroll from the Father himself, which in the ancient world, no one except the Son would approach a Father in that kind of position. Anyway, interesting thought. I'll go down any bunny trail you want to go on here. These are some of these are fun. So, Les.
I have a footnote here that says Paul's a rabbi, and he warned them not to walk the way the rabbis were taught to walk because they had a code of order, tradition how they were to do things. They were written down. If you're referring to not to put their belief in circumcision and the Sabbath worship and the diet and all those things.
Well, I don't think he's there here. I mean, what he wants them to understand is to walk worthy of the Lord. And I think there's a certain sense in which any devout believing Jew would, you know, feel comfortable with that kind of language. But he is going to say, when he gets to chapter 2, the attempt to impose the law on people and the attempt to give them rules and regulations, he says it has an outward appearance of wisdom, but it cuts you off from the truth because you lose contact with the head that way. In other words, what he wants these people to understand is that the only way you live a Christian life is by looking to Jesus, not by looking at the law, and not by looking at rituals, even if they were given by God. Ultimately, you've got your eyes on the wrong place if you do that. So I think that that's sort of implicit, and it's going to become more evident when you get it into the end of chapter 2, that whole issue. What are the implications? If Jesus is who he is, what are the implications for ceremonies and food laws and Sabbath laws and things like that? Nikki.
When you were talking about God's will, you got to the declared will, moral will, and his commands, and you quoted the commandments, you got down to the fourth. I'm wondering if you can talk about how that one would be included in his moral commands.
Oh, I was just going through his declared will more than trying to. Can we leave that question? It will come up more directly when we get to chapter 2.
Sure.
I think if we try to go off on that one, we'll never get back onto this track. So I don't want to avoid the question, but I don't. Okay, can we go then to the next part and talk about these four? Oh, okay, we're going to go faster here. Okay, there's four, but there's some really good stuff here, so bear with me. Four participles. Remember them, and we can go through the first couple fairly quickly. So, first of all, bearing fruit in good works. So the first evidence or the first... Is this a product? I put in my notes just because I like the P, keep it, petition, purpose, product. Product is a fruit-bearing life. Now, it's interesting that he uses that analogy and that word because he's already, do you remember up in verse 6, he already used that. He said, the gospel has come to you, indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing. That's verse 6. Now he uses those two words again here in at the end of verse 10 when he says, bearing fruit in every good work and growing, same word as he used earlier, it's translated differently here, growing in the knowledge of God. So, but the point here is bearing fruit is not the product of effort, it is the product of life. Right? No tree stands there and says, plums appear. The issue as a tree is it rooted? Does it have nutrients? And so bearing fruit is the overflow of life. And here, the bearing of fruit is good works. Now, good fruit is the product of life. It is not the cause of life, good work. Understand? I mean, it's a critical distinction. And when we get further in this chapter, we're going to see it. If there isn't an evidence of fruit, of good life, there is questions about the presence of salvation. So that we are not saved by good works, but we are saved for good works. And as a matter of fact, many of us will remember the famous words of Ephesians chapter 2. For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. But Paul goes even further in Titus chapter 2 and verse 14, when he says, looking for the blessed hope, even the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who redeemed us for himself that he might have a people eager for good works. And that becomes actually the word is zelotes, zealous, zealots for good works. We've got Muslim zealots running around doing horrible things. And Christians are to be zealots too. But what we're to be zealots for is good works. Because that's how the life of the Lord is produced in us. And that's what the Lord Jesus said. Your light so shine before people that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who's in heaven. So, the knowing of God's will produces a life that pleases God, which is demonstrated by the fruit of good works. Now, other times in the Bible, fruit is good godly character, and other times it's spiritual conversion, you know, God bringing other people. But here it's very specific. So, bearing fruit, then the second participle, growing in the knowledge of God. Now, it's really interesting because we started with the knowledge of God, that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will, so you may walk worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, so that you will be growing in the knowledge of God. But here's a critical truth about the Christian life. The Christian life isn't a circle, it's a spiral. So you start by knowing God, and then you grow and you please him, so you get to know him better. Not because he's changed, but because you've increased your capacity to know him. And there's a spiraling. That's why Paul can say, after years of being a Christian, in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, that I may know him. You know, I left everything behind for the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom the world is lost, and I count it but dung, that I may know Christ. I want to know Christ. That's what he's saying. I mean, I know Christ, but I want to know Christ. That's what marriage is all about too, isn't it? I mean, in a very different way. I knew Elizabeth and wanted to know Elizabeth. And here we are 47 years married and want to know Elizabeth. And she's got a very much more challenging problem because I've got the depth of a mud puddle. She's got the depth of a good-sized swimming pool. But God's the Pacific Ocean. And so, you know, so we're growing in the knowledge of God. I'm going to pay for this when I get home tonight. Okay, now the third participle. So we've got growing... bearing fruit, growing or increasing, as it's put here, being strengthened, as verse 11 actually is. Remember here, it's another participle, although our translators have made it easier to read in English. Being strengthened with all power. So let me just talk a little bit about this. With all power, what is it? How's it translating? Strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. Now, the word being strengthened, literally it says being enabled with all enablement. I don't want to make this tedious, but it's worth knowing some of these things. The basic word for power in the Greek language is dunamis. That's not very important. But it comes over into English. But it comes over into English in two very different ways. Dynamite and dynamo. Now, the difference between dynamite is its power to blow things to pieces. Dynamo produces this power to enable things to do that they were created to do. It's empowerment, not power in its raw strength. The word that's used here is not the word for raw power. It's the word for empowerment or enablement, being strengthened with all strengthening, being enabled with all enablement. And look what it's for. What does God want you to have power to be able to do? All endurance and patience. In other words, the enablement and the strength. This is the other big prayer request constantly in Paul. Remember, we quoted or read Ephesians chapter 3. For this reason, I bow my knee before the Father, from whom the entire family in heaven and earth derives its name, that according to his glorious might you be strengthened with power by the Spirit in the inner man. That Christ may dwell in your heart and faith, that you may live in love, that you may, anyway, won't go into all of that. But the point is the difference between endurance and patience. Endurance is the ability to put up with circumstances. Patience is the ability to put up with people. So I want you to have endurance for the tough circumstances. And sometimes the circumstances are the people. I mean, I understand that. But but being strengthened, and of course, if we're thinking biblically, it's interesting. I mentioned last week, Paul doesn't use the word Spirit, meaning the Holy Spirit, after he used it in verse 8. But consistently, enablement, empowering, is the work of God's Holy Spirit living within the believer, that, as I quoted from Ephesians, that you would be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. Okay, so bearing fruit, growing, being strengthened, and then giving thanks. And we mentioned last week that giving thanks is in the book of Colossians, as elsewhere in the New Testament, a primary characteristic of a life that pleases God. An unthankful Christian is a non-pleasing Christian. God takes no pleasure in cranks. And I remember as a young man, I can still tell you where I was sitting, listening to a man who God used. He was an Australian. And he was pretty typical Australian, but God used him to start InterVarsity Christian Fellowship in Canada and then in the United States and then what's called the International Fellowship of Evangelical Students in Europe. And Stacy Woods was his name. And I can remember as an 18-year-old listening to Stacy, who was not a young guy at that stage, saying, I pray every day, Lord, keep me from becoming a cranky old man. And I mean, that stuck in my mind. I don't know why that hit an 18-year-old or a 19-year-old. But I thought, boy, if he needed to pray that, that means you could become that. And over the years, I've discovered that there's a lot of people who haven't been praying that prayer enough. And So thankfulness is a characteristic of the Lord. But I want you to notice the three things that we are to be thankful for. And I mentioned to, when I was responding to Norm earlier, there's more going on here than it looks like. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, we read over that statement, and we don't read it the way a Jewish person would read it. Because qualified for a share of the inheritance in the of the saints in light would take every Jewish mind back to when Joshua conquered the land of Israel. And then they divided up the land, and every family group received a share of the inheritance. That's an Old Testament term about our family plot in the promised land. And to have a share in the inheritance, I mean, there's all kinds of rules in the land of Israel that on the year of Jubilee, for example, every 70th year, every family got their land back. And it all started again. You had your share. Nobody owned land in Israel permanently. They just had, the Lord owned the land, and they got to use it. And they had a share in the inheritance, was the gift of God. And at the year of Jubilee, the debts were freed, and you got your land back. So now he says, you have received, and many of the people who are from a Gentile background wouldn't understand that nearly as quickly as the ones from a Jewish background would. God has qualified you. You didn't earn it. It was a gift of God for an inheritance, a share in the inheritance of the saints, of God's people, in this case, in the realm of light. And he's going to explain that in just a minute by the next terms. So the first thing that God has given us is an inheritance in his kingdom of light, or in his land. And keep reading here and keep your Old Testament hats on. He's delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of the Son he loves. Delivered from the domain of darkness. What would you think of if you were Jewish?
Exodus.
The Exodus from Egypt. When they were delivered from the domain of darkness and they were transferred into another nation. They became God's people. At Mount Sinai, God entered into a covenant with them and brought them into that place, and they were, their citizenship changed. They were under the domain of darkness. And ultimately, that's saying here, Satan and all that's involved there. In Ephesians chapter 2, it talks about you were following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now rules in the children of disobedience. You were by nature the children of wrath, even like the rest. I mean, all of that's in his background here. But he says you've been delivered. And not only have you been delivered, you've been given citizenship in a kingdom. But what kingdom? The kingdom of the Son whom God loves. Now, I don't, again, have time to go into all of this, but in the background of that, the kingdom of the Son he loves is the promise God made to David. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, I will be to him father, he will be to me a son, and you will have a king. It's the messianic king, the son of his love. But almost everywhere else in the New Testament, the kingdom is spoken of as the kingdom of God. Here it's the kingdom of God's Son. It's one of the places where now he's beginning to put God the Father and God the Son on the same level. So we've been qualified for an inheritance we didn't have any right to. We've been domain shifted. Kingdom shifted over into the kingdom of the Son whom he loves. And then in whom, referring to the Son, in whom we have redemption. What would you hear if you're a Jewish person and hear redemption? They were redeemed from Egypt. Again, it's the Passover lamb that was the price of redemption, as they were bought out from the land, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Now, redemption is a word that means what? Do you remember? Redeem is to buy out of bondage, to buy out of slavery, to buy out of belonging to another. They were slaves in Egypt in Old Testament. Now, all of those symbols have been fulfilled in Christ. They were, and it's kind of worked backwards, because we started with inheriting the land, and now we get to verse 14, and we're getting to redemption. Actually, in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7, he says the same thing. He says, in whom we have redemption, but he adds a phrase in Ephesians that he doesn't add in Colossians, at least in our best manuscripts of Colossians. If you have a King James, you'll find it in there, but it says, in whom we have redemption, Ephesians 1:7, through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. So the redemption is by the work of Christ. And the forgiveness of sins is what that amounts to. Here's an interesting thing. How many times do you think Paul uses the expression the forgiveness of sins? Twice. Here, Colossians 1:14 and Ephesians 1:7. He uses the word forgiveness on other occasions, but it's the only time. Paul prefers to talk not about the forgiveness of sins, but about being justified, about being declared righteous in Christ. It's not that he didn't believe in the forgiveness of sins. He clearly did, and it's going to be talked about more. But justification is a fuller and richer term, because in forgiveness of sins, you lose your sins. In justification, you also receive Christ's righteousness. So he liked to think of us not just as naked without sin. He'd like us to think of us clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Now, I probably lost you all in this last little bit, but I really like verses 12 to 14. And what are we to be thankful for? You're to be thankful because once you were a stranger and you had no claim on God whatsoever, he's going to say those are going to be the words he uses in verse 21. You were strangers with no claim on God, and now you're an heir. And once you were in bondage, under the domain of darkness, under Satan, and now you've been rescued, but you just haven't been rescued, you've been repatriated. You've been put into another kingdom, and you have a whole new identity. And thirdly, you have redemption. Now, I want you to notice one other thing that is utterly crucial to understand. When is this happening? That's a really vague way of putting it. Is this something that's going to happen or something that has happened? Giving thanks that you have been qualified for an inheritance. You were in the domain, but you've been rescued and you've been transferred, in whom you have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Salvation is on one level an accomplished fact. It isn't something that we get in part and we begin. Now, there's a whole other way of talking about it. And it says, yeah, we've not yet received it in full, but it's no question that we're going to get it. I mean, my little child, when they were little children, may just be newborns, but they were heirs then. Not of much, unfortunately, but nevertheless, they were heirs. And so salvation, Paul wants them to understand, is something that you have in Christ. He's going to say later on, before this chapter is over, if you genuinely have believed. And we'll get to that. Okay. Sorry, I get a little bit carried away on some of these things, and getting carried away on this because I enjoy it. But let's just see if there's any questions that you have or any things that we should clarify for us. What did I say? 70?
Seven.
Yeah. 7 times 7 plus 1.
Yeah, I figured you were just thinking of the 7.
Sabbatical year times 7 sabbatical years and the 50th year of the year Jubilee. Thank you for correcting me. All right. Well, let's pray. We'll pick it up next week. We get the privilege of looking at one of the greatest passages on the person of Christ in the New Testament, and Colossians is a great book, and just keeps, can't get much better than next week, but it stays at a pretty high level all the way through. So Father, thank you for your grace to us in Christ. How wonderful it is, through faith in you, people who have no claim upon you, people who we're under bondage to our own sinfulness and our own waywardness, and ultimately because of that, under the power and control, even though we didn't recognize it, of the Prince of Darkness, through our Lord Jesus Christ, have been rescued, transferred, made an inheritance, redeemed, and forgiven. Help us to know more of your will in Christ so that we may walk worthy of the Lord and please you in all respects. In Christ's name, amen.